We're back to the Total Celebrity Show on the Neil Haley Network, and I'm excited to welcome the program. Had an unbelievable conversation with her about a year ago. She's doing some tremendous work with her show. Holly Robinson Pete, how are you? Meet the Petes, and thanks for coming by and chatting with me again.
It's great to talk to you again, Neil. Everything's great. Very busy, doing a whole lot, and enjoying life. Thank you so much for having me again.
Exactly. And it's got to be exciting about how you are doing such great work with autism awareness with your show. Wouldn't you agree? And the feedback of the families and everything.
Neil, I can't even tell you. So we have been advocating for families affected by autism for years now. But there's nothing like having a network, a successful television powerhouse like Hallmark Channel behind us to really help us with our mission. I mean, they just get what we're trying to do. They get how we are focused in showing RJ winning in life and doing the things, how that's helping other families. This season on Meet the Petes, I mean, it's so impactful. We're opening RJ's Place to help families impacted by autism and Parkinson's, like my son and my dad. And
oh, great.
Getting these young people jobs, Neil. I mean, that is so important. So you get to see that on Meet the Petes. And we just can't, I can't tell you how amazing of a partner they've been in our family mission. So just really a blessing.
Well, I'm glad to hear that. And I'm so excited to hear about the whole thing about getting them jobs. I have a great story of one of my college kids that graduated and now has a job, and I'm helping him, coaching him, but he's moving into an apartment and he has Asperger's, and it's just a tremendous story. And those are the kind of stories that you love to see and you want, and that they can do this, and we should never give up on them. And
you don't get to see that on television very much, which is one of the reasons why I really wanted to do this docuseries. I wanted to show people what it looks like, what autism looks like in this family. Of course, like you know, Neil, one kid with autism, one person with autism is just one person with autism or Asperger's. Everyone's really different. But this is just important to show a family supporting and rallying around a young kid, and to show how beautiful, amazing, and worthwhile they are. They're just so valuable to the community. You know, RJ's getting ready. You know, he works with the Dodgers. He's getting ready for opening day. The kid is working like 18-hour days to get these jerseys ready and get all this stuff ready. And he's got a pretty intense job, but it has given him a sense of purpose. And I can't tell you what a game changer it's been. So we want that for all people with autism and on the spectrum to show what they can do.
Fabulous. Now, our topic today is a different one. We're going to talk about, again, grand traveling. This is interesting, right? That we dealt with this, my parents, and have gone on vacation with us, and it's really helped in a lot of ways, because then you can enjoy the vacation, not just to always have to spend the time with kids. But tell us this latest trend.
Yeah, so I'm partnering with Visit Anaheim to encourage grand traveling. Grand traveling, like you said, is just bringing grandma and grandpa along. And, you know, Visit Anaheim did this survey, a grand travel survey, and found out surprisingly that millennials just love this whole concept of grand travel. I don't know if it's because they want to put grandma and grandpa on the gram, if they like using them on their content and their videos. I don't know what it is, but I'm telling you, millennials are really behind this. And some of the other things we found in the survey was that a lot of these multi-generational trips are likely road trips. We took an RV road trip to Arizona and Meet the Petes and had one of those trips. And the benefits are bonding and just connection. The connectivity between the generations is so, so important. And then more than half said that their kids had already taken vacations with just grandma and grandpa. So really excited about this this trend. I think it's great. Anybody that knows me knows I have a mom who's, you know, 82 going on 42, and she's always
That's
in
great.
The mix. We travel with her all the time.
And you're right about this, and the connectivity, the ability to really honor grandparents, but also the whole family, and planning really fun events and different things, and it's really family-friendly, right?
It is so family-friendly, and if you go to visitanaheim.org, you can enter a contest, a grand travel contest through April 30th. You can win a vacation for six. Includes tickets to Knott's Berry Farm and the awesome Great Wolf Lodge. So go to visitanaheim.org and get that trip for your family and your grandparents.
There's so much more to a vacation now, Holly, right? In the planning. I think television's caused it, Facebook's caused it, but really there is a lot more than just, okay, we're going on a trip. The planning alone takes some time, right?
Yes, lots of planning. And what I love, I have to say, if you're a smart parent and you bring grandma and grandpa along, they might be your babysitter for a night out with your husband. I'm just saying, Neil, that is something that, you know, might be a little bit of a perk to this situation.
It's a definite perk because, again, if you're just going on vacation with your kids when they're small, really you don't have that time alone. But bring your grandparents along and look out.
And then what do you need? A vacation from your vacation.
Oh, yeah. And that's the great thing. And then the grandparents will watch your kids and you can go travel. that's the winning.
You can do stuff. Yeah. And so, but just for me, I just love how my kids bond with my mom and create these great memories. It's one thing to say, hey, grandma and grandpa, I wish you were here, but they can actually be there and experience the vacation with you. I think that's very cool.
And I think that you like, as you said, what you able to show on Meet the Peets to really tell people about how fun this is. This will get lots of families more closer together. Close-knit family, such an important thing.
It really is, and that's what we're all about on Meet the Peets. It's all about family support, sticking together, being there for the good times, the bad times, you know, vacationing together, hanging out, and experiencing life together. And you know, one of the things about Anaheim, which is interesting, is I live in L.A., most of my life in L.A., and Anaheim was our, like, go-to staycation destination. It's so much bigger than L.A. You know, you think of L.A. because it's such a big city, but Anaheim has so much to do. So when you go to visitanaheim.org to try to win this contest, just take a look at some of the cool things that there are to do out Anaheim. People think it's just Disneyland, but there's so much more. And the angels are out there, and it's just, you know, you got the Anaheim Garden Walk and the ducks and Knott's and Great Wolf. And so a whole bunch of stuff to do in Anaheim. Great place to visit.
And not as crazy as sometimes downtown, Hollywood would be. So you kind of can enjoy it. And there's a lot more family friendliness in Anaheim. So that's a great plus to talk about Anaheim in that way, for sure.
Yes, for sure.
All right, so ultimate goal with the show, Holly, just because we have a couple more minutes left, ultimate goal, where do you want to see, you talk about, you know, finding autistic children and adults, jobs and different things. What is your ultimate goal with the show moving forward, as long as you're able to do it?
Well, this season has been amazing so far. We're about halfway through it, and, I mean, just what we've been able to do with the job fair and doing all of these, you know, just Hollyrod Foundation in general. We've been at this raising funds for families impacted by autism and Parkinson's for over 20 years, and never have we seen sort of even the community support, but certainly the corporate support that we've gotten just because we're, you know, on TV and we're able to really talk about these stories has been phenomenal. I mean, it has been exponential. So moving forward, you know, we have a lot of really cool things that we're doing. But opening RJ's Place is the number one thing. So that's going to be a hub of compassionate care for families impacted by autism and Parkinson's. And, of course, a job training, pre-vocational training center for these young people. But it has been amazing, like I said, Neil, having this partner in Hallmark Channel. And hopefully, you know, if we come back next season, we'll be able to do some more support for these families impacted by autism. It's just been an absolute blessing.
The fans on the Hallmark Channel are awesome, aren't they, Holly? It's a huge community that people don't understand until you finally find out that community online and stuff, right?
Yeah, we call them Hallmarkies, and they are a powerful fan base that will stick with you and support what you support. And I have found going through airports and everything that we've done, like, just the support that we've had from being on this network and from being part of this Hallmark Channel family has been just unbelievable. So many people in this country are impacted by autism. You know, it's more than people realize. So I think seeing RJ's story and watching his journey has been inspirational, and that was really the goal of Meet the Peets.
All right, best place we can find information on Anaheim, visit Anaheim, and also you. Where's the best place we can go?
Well, visitanaheim.org. Check that out to try to win that grand travel contest. Take your grandparents to Anaheim. You're going to have a great time. And for us, hollyrod.org, you can visit that. And I'm all over social media. My husband says too much, but that's another story. at Holly R. Pete. You can find me on Instagram and Twitter.
You're fabulous. Great chatting with you again, Holly. Best of luck and continued success with the show and your work with autism. So thanks for calling.
Thanks, Neil. Good to talk to you, too.
All right, take care then. See you later. Okay.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. You're listening to Neil Haley's show, and we'll be back in just a moment. We're back to the Neil Haley Show on the Total Celebrity segment, and I'm excited to welcome to the program Lorraine Toussaint of NBC's The Village. How are you, Lorraine, and thanks for calling.
Well, thank you, Neil. Nice to talk to you again.
Oh, it's fabulous to talk to you as well. And this show is really, really, really interesting. And we talked to some of the characters earlier this week on last week's episode. Now we're talking about episode 2. Let's talk a little bit about your character, first of all, and then we'll get into The Village a little bit more.
Sure.
Yes.
My character,
yes.
Patricia, is she's in life, she's a social worker. Married. My husband is Ron. He's the super of the building. We've lived in the building the longest. As a social worker, she goes into people's homes and deals with all sorts of very intimate human issues. And so she is clearly well-versed in that language. She is a big-hearted girl who really does care about human suffering, the human condition. So it's a natural transition that in this family, she is the mother hen. She is the den mom. She's the heart. And so all the different characters of the village end up coming to Patricia, referencing Patricia in one form or another, legally, emotionally, physically. She's a soft place to land our Patricia.
Yeah, and it's very interesting when you talk about that, Lorraine, that your character's in the perfect position. Your husband's the superintendent of the building, and you're a social worker, so you're going to be looking out for how you can help others. So your day doesn't end after your day as a social worker, does it?
No, but then none of our jobs end. You know, when we finish the work we do, we go home, and we interact. If we're very lucky, we have families at home, or we have friends that have become family. And I'm very careful how many new friends I take on, not Patricia but Lorraine, how I take on, because I really do want to service my friends. I want to give energy and focus to my friends. And I think I can only do that intimately with X number of people. So my village is, I don't know how I'd live without my little village.
You're right. Your profession is your calling. Hopefully when people make the choice of what they're going to do in life and what they do on a regular basis, they don't take that hat off when they get home. And your passion to choose as a social worker, as your character, brings that. And I'm sure through the building, the different people, the different backgrounds, really, it helps that you are really keeping everything together. Because we talked about on another interview I did with some people from the village, we talked about specifically enough how people really don't talk to each other anymore. They're not friendly with each other anymore. They're forgetting about each other in these complexes or neighbors and stuff like that. In the village, you guys aren't going to put up with that, right? You want to have those relationships and those connections being made in the building.
Oh, yeah. We really do. And you know, it harkens back to a time when maybe we weren't quite so gentrified or in the big cities, we weren't quite so physically isolated. The complexes weren't quite so vast. You know, I live on the 38th floor of a building here in Manhattan. That's a lot of floors. But when I was growing up, I lived in a fourth floor walk-up in Hell's Kitchen. It was very much like the building. I knew all of the residents of the building. We really did come together. We had courtyard parties, and And, you know, if you heard a sound, if you heard something go bump in the night, you open your door and you stuck your head out and you said, what's going on? Are you guys okay? Are you guys okay down there? What's going on? So people who think that this is an idealistic kind of village, it really isn't. This harkens back to the world that I grew up in here, in the middle of New York City, in Brooklyn, in fact.
And you're hoping through this show that the way we communicate changes and that we really look at our neighbors and care about what's happening with them, not just about our lives, but become a village.
I really do hope that, because if there's one takeaway that I'd like is that this is a normal way to be. To walk into an elevator and recognize the people there. Or if you don't, say good morning. I'm surprised at how often I walk into an elevator and in my building, and these are my neighbors. And nobody says good morning, as though you're standing shoulder to shoulder pretending you're not there. It's the oddest thing. I don't know how to do that. My 14-year-old is always so chagrined when she says, why do you have to talk to everyone like that? I go, because I don't know how to not do that. I don't pretend very well. So, you know, go downstairs, ask the old lady if she needs help. You go to the supermarket, does she need milk, does she need butter? You're coming back. It takes so little and means so much.
It does, for sure, and that's the goal. But also, I wanted to talk to you a little bit, because we have a little bit of time, about some of your other projects coming up. Can you tell us about some of them?
Oh, yeah. I've got the third season of Into the Badlands on the 24th. That drops on the 24th on AMC, and I believe Netflix at the same time. I'm shooting in Ireland for the last year, playing... Cressida, she's dystopic, post-apocalyptic sorceress, empath, who is the military strategist for the new group that comes into the Badlands and takes it over. So I was flying through the air in harnesses, doing a lot of martial arts last year in Ireland. And that was big fun. That's actually a very exciting, quite violent third season. I've got a film that's opening this month called Fast Color, where I play, it's about three generations of women with unusual abilities and powers. It's a very feminine superhero film. So I've got, and then there's She-Ra, which... My teenager is very pleased that mom is doing She-Ra.
So you're staying really busy. Wow. You have the village and you have much, yeah. much more. So I think that's nice about all these platforms for more and more opportunities to stay busy, because you shoot for only a certain amount of time for one show, and then you go and shoot the other show and then do movies. So you're constantly working.
Yes, I'm good. I'm happiest when I'm working. It's funny, I tend to balance my life better when I'm working, but you know, it's everything in moderation. I've got a little bit of downtime at the moment, which I'm also really enjoying.
Absolutely. So, ultimate goal, and what should we expect for episode 2 for people that tuned in for episode 1, and they can always catch up at NBC.com to check out more info on, you know, the first episode. But what should we expect in episode 2? A little without spoilers.
You know, in episode 2, with episode 1, we just set up the characters and where they are in their lives, and we begin to delve into the lives of each character. You know that Patricia has had a diagnosis of cancer in the first episode, so we really dive deep in episodes 2 and 3 there. You see the Dominic Chinese's character is now living with his grandson. You see Ron dealing with Patricia. You see Sarah dealing, indeed, with her daughter's pregnancy. That story starts to really open up. The Iranian woman played by Moran, she's still being helped. It gets a bit I see there. So you begin to delve into the lives of these characters and begin to hopefully invest in them and come along on our lovely journey.
Well, that's fantastic. Best place we can connect with you, Lorraine, and everyone needs to tune in to NBC's The Village. But where can we find information on you and learn more about you?
I've got all sorts of websites, Lorraine Toussaint, LP Toussaint. I'm on all of the social media platforms, and everydaylovelybylorraine.com. That's my website. And Into the Badlands, Fast Color, She-Ra, they're all dropping in March.
Well, fantastic. Thanks for calling, Lorraine. Best of luck and continued success.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome. Bye-bye. You're listening to Neil Haley's show. When we'll be back in just a moment. Bye-bye. We're back to the Neil Haley Show in the Total Celebrity segment. I'm excited to welcome to the show Natalie Morales and Nelson Franklin of NBC's Abby's. Guys, how are you? And thanks for calling.
Oh, we're good. Thanks for having us.
Much better now.
Yeah.
Thanks for having us, yeah.
I'm excited to talk to you as well. And it's a very interesting storyline, Natalie, isn't it? Abby's. You think about, okay, a bar in San Diego, but it's a different type of bar, isn't it?
It's an illegal outdoor backyard bar, and we shot every single episode outside with a live audience.
Wow, with a live audience. So that's got to be wild. Nelson, that's got to be a strange recording, isn't it, outside and live?
Oh, yeah, I was pretty worried about it at first, but then I realized it's the best thing ever.
It was so fun.
That all of our jobs were outside. We get to be outside all day.
Yeah, it was really Southern California. It was really fun, yeah.
So, Natalie, did it take place? Did you film in San Diego, even though they say it's in San Diego?
We shot at Universal Studios. In the back lot at Universal Studios, there's like a neighborhood street, which is where they shot Desperate Housewives. Yep. It was like that's the Wisteria Lane or the Leave It to Beaver Street or the Munsters Street, what have you. In the back of one of those houses on that street, they built a whole bar set, and that's where we shot it.
It's a real house in a real backyard.
Yeah.
All right, so Nelson, so you were hoping good weather all the time, right? Especially days of shooting.
Yes, yes. We did have a backup. They built a replica of the set on a stage, but we ended up never using it because we never got any rain, which is lucky, but also we need the rain.
So. Yeah.
Hey, but you know, you're Southern California. It's raining right now in Pittsburgh, so I have to deal with it. So, Natalie, let's talk about your character and talk about the show. I've kind of already delved into the strange storyline. You think of a bar, say, all right, a bar, you start reading the storyline, and you say outdoors and illegal. Okay, so Natalie, tell us about it. Yeah.
Yeah, it's, I play Abby, who started this bar in her backyard, and I think she was working at a few different bars in her life and was just sort of tired of people telling her what to do and tired of how gross some bar environments can be, so she decided to do her own thing.
And that's interesting. And so, Nelson, you didn't like that, right? Your character does not like that at all, right, at first, finding out about Natalie's activity, right?
Yeah. So she's been getting away with having this bar in her backyard because her landlord has been like this 99-year-old woman who lives in another state and sort of never knew what was going on. But when I inherit the property, I immediately am really freaked out. I'm like, you got to shut this down. I could go to jail. You know, this is a big problem. And I agree to let the bar open only because my character Bill is sort of at a sad time in his life. He just got divorced and he sort of lost a lot of his friends in the divorce. And he decided, you know, these could be my new friends. And he's sort of persuaded to leave the bar open as long as he can hang out there.
So definitely a comedy, Natalie. And your character, I'm sure, is going to go things. But your bar is different than any bar, even though it's illegal and it's outdoors. Also, you have other rules. So you have more rules and regulations than regular bars do, don't you, Natalie?
That's true.
Yeah, we do, but the rules are decided by a committee of regulars. So the rules are in place to keep the bar, you know, the same place that we all want to hang out in. So the rules are stuff like no cell phones and no visors and all tacos are group tacos.
Yeah, you know, quality of life stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah, but see, Nelson, there you go. So there is not really illegal activity. You have to kind of chill out, because not allowing cell phones, it's a great thing, right? Because I don't think the bar scene's like when I was going to bars, Nelson, and I possibly when you have gone to bars as well, the scene's completely different. Everyone's staring at the phone, right?
Oh, yeah, yeah. No, if I had my way, I'm sure it would be like this at all bars with no phone. Look, you need a phone, I get it. But also, you're there to have a drink with someone you know or to meet somebody.
Also, when it's an illegal bar, you don't want anybody taking pictures.
That's true, too, yeah.
Mm-hmm. So awesome, great. And I think that the kind of patrons we're going to see, it's going to be interesting, right, Natalie? The people you invite, you have to be the chosen, right, in certain ways that have certain connectivity and stuff. Yeah.
Yeah, anybody can walk in, but to be a regular and to have a seat at the bar is a very coveted honor, which only very few get.
Yeah, it's a long process. So if you get to sit at that bar, you've really won the place over. You've made it.
Uh-huh.
And that's sort of the gift they give me to just keep it open in that term. Shut it down.
Awesome. And, Nelson, your character in this show, a little different than any other character or kind of similar in some ways?
This character is... Yeah, I feel like I usually play like a guy who's like pretty tame or like lame or like lets people walk all over him. And this time it's a little different. I mean, he's his own guy, Bill, and he's like the boss of the property or whatever. You know, he's the landlord, and he acts as such. He's sort of annoying, but he's also got a much softer side. And this is one of my favorite characters I've ever played because it's sort of the most like me, which is that I'm a little stiff, but also I can relax a little bit.
Yeah.
Absolutely. And Natalie, your character, do you feel it's different than some of the other characters you've played?
Definitely. I mean, I've never played. Abby is a Marine vet. She was a staff sergeant. She did two tours in Afghanistan. I've never played a vet before, so that's exciting. And I think this is the first time I get to play someone who is like this protective of a place that she's built and will fight you for it. It's very fun to play her. I certainly don't have things in common with her. Like I wouldn't want all these people at my house, but I appreciate some of her other values.
And it's always interesting to see those characters, but everyone needs to tune in. I hope that you have success as a bar show. We all know one successful bar show. Let's hope that this can do that for sure. That's when you read that and say, hey, you don't see those storylines, but it's a little different. It's definitely this age type of a bar show, but everyone needs to tune in again Thursday nights, 9:30 p.m. Eastern, to Abby's on NBC. Guys, thanks for calling. I appreciate you coming on the show.
Thanks for having us.
All right, take care. All right, thanks. Take care. All right, bye-bye. Bye. You listen to the Neil Haley Show, and we'll be back in just a moment.
We're back to the Neil Haley Show in the Total Celebrity segment. And, you know, when I think about a guy that I've not talked to in about a year, maybe because I'm afraid to have to buy him his steak dinners and all that stuff. And I don't know if Brandon Lang's in Vegas. If he is in Vegas, I will be there April 8th to 12th. But I'm in deep trouble if that's the case. But he's everywhere. Brandon Lang. Brandon, how are you? A celebrity handicapper. And last time, how many steak dinners did I owe you when I just really fell apart during the football season with you? I was on the roll and then I was really banking on the Steelers two seasons ago. If you remember correctly.
Yeah, you're in trouble. I live in Vegas now. I'll be here when you come here. So you better bring your wallet or your credit card. I'll take you to Morton's. That's simple. I'll get the Cajun ribeye. That's simple. That's $40. Cajun ribeye is $40. A side of cream spinach, side of broccoli, asparagus. That'll put you in the neighborhood of 80, and then we'll have to go ahead and get, we'll drink two bottles of wine at dinner. I won't hit you too hard. I think all in soup to nuts with tip, you're probably going to get in out of there for about 400. That's what's going to cost you for the steak dinner and I don't know, your three bottles of wine that you lost to me. So that's not bad.
Brandon, we might have to go to McDonald's, but we'll see. Well, we'll have to, unless of my company, I'll say the company that's taking me to Vegas will take care of you, Brandon, you know, but never know. All right, let's talk March Madness. I always go by history. I always go by history of some of these teams, like good old UVA. I remember, oh my gosh, did I have you on the show when I told you UVA wasn't going to the Final Four? I got to go back. That's when the last time I think we did a football one before. I think March Madness last year was when you came on, and you were the one that was shooting to the mountaintops about UVA. I gotcha. And good old UVA, I said the history of UVA and the tournament, and they constantly choke, and you said nothing, and then that unbelievable thing happened, Brandon.
Well, they're in trouble this year as well, because they're going to run into an Oregon Ducks team that's going to send them home. This Oregon team is legit. Last year, I gave the World Loyola Chicago to the Final Four. They were an 11 seed. I'm going to one-up myself this year and give you a 12 seed Oregon Ducks to the Final Four, beating Virginia in the Sweet 16 and Tennessee in the Elite Eight.
I mean, what about my team to win it all is Duke. I think Duke's winning it all. I just think that this year...
You want to put three bottles of wine and a steak dinner on that?
Oh, my gosh. And then by the time April 8th comes...
Listen, I'm never going to collect anyway. You just made that perfectly clear. He might as well do what Michael Jordan does. He just keeps doubling down until he finally wins.
But see, at least we get to meet, and then we'll see what happens, and we'll have to figure it out, and I might be able to put it as a meal for my company, and I hope they're not listening. But we'll have to figure... But we got to meet in Vegas, that's for sure. I can't believe we might be together in Vegas. I have so many people that want to connect with me in Vegas. It's crazy. April 8th to 12th, I'll be at ISC West with Lensec, and then also the NEB, National Broadcast Association deals there too, the NEB. So it's just a crazy week in Vegas. But all right, so Brandon, let's jump right specifically in enough. I think
here's
Duke's
why
winning.
Duke doesn't win at all.
Why Duke doesn't win? Okay.
In the one-and-done era, no team has ever won a national championship yet.
Oh, yes. One of the Duke teams did with a one-and-done guy.
No, they didn't.
I'll have to go back to...
When's the last time Duke won the national championship?
Okay, what year was it? So you have it on your radar?
No, I don't pay attention to Duke. Here's the main reason why. In the history of the NCAA tournament, any team ranked 300th or worse in three-point field goal percentage has never won the national championship. Duke ranks 311th. That, my friend, is why your Blue Devils will not win the national championship. And they will either get knocked out in the Sweet 16 by Virginia Tech, or they will get knocked out in the Elite Eight by Michigan State, or they will get knocked out by Michigan or Texas Tech or Gonzaga in the Final Four. If they somehow get through all that, they will get knocked off by North Carolina in the national championship game. Take the field against Duke. They are not winning the national championship.
So do you think that North Carolina has enough strength? I mean, I think you could see a North Carolina-Duke national championship game?
No, I think Michigan State beats Duke.
What makes you think that the Big Ten this year has shown any sort of power? History sometimes shows. I think that this year's the one year where it could even be crazier than last year with all the upsets. Is that a chance?
It's the matchup. The matchup of how these two teams match up with one another. See, if you can put a body on Zion, he's going to struggle. Michigan State has 3 6'11" beasts who could be bouncers at any hot Manhattan nightclub. Ward, Goins, Tillman. Allow me to introduce Zion Williamson to those three, and they can rotate those three all game long. They are deep at the center spot. Matt McQuaid, lockdown defender, he will be on JT Barrett. I'll be shocked if JT Barrett gets 20 points. Michigan State, if they meet Duke in the Elite Eight, will send Coach K and the Dukies home from the NCAA tournament.
Okay, so I mean, I hear what you're saying. I would tell you if the number one seeds, Virginia's not going to make it to the Final Four. I think we all agree on that. Gonzaga's not going to make it to the Final Four either. I don't see Gonzaga as a team that's going to go to the Final Four. Let's look at number one seeds. Carolina could. Is there a dark? You were talking about your dark horse, Oregon. I don't know about why you're so high on Oregon. What's the reasoning?
saw him play in person. Went and saw him play against Arizona State at the T-Mobile Center here in Vegas Friday night. Then went and watched the championship game against Washington, playing their fourth game in four nights. They walked in that gym like they're playing a scrimmage on Saturday afternoon. Energy, 6'9", gazelles, they're healthy. Senior point guard Pritchard, who was the point guard on their Final Four team when he was a freshman. Nobody's really seen this team play. They've won eight in a row. They're playing their best ball of the year. They got a great coach in Dana Altman. They got a great draw in this South bracket. I'm telling you, green and gold, baby. Oregon Ducks.
I say, looking at this bracket, I say watch out for Syracuse. The matchup zone always gives people problems, and I could see them go far. Yes, that's my dark horse is Syracuse.
Howard isn't playing one of their starters. Battle is banged up, didn't play in the ACC tournament. Good luck with that. Syracuse is out like a fat girl in dodgeball.
All right, so we have to go to BrianLang.com to get your pick for the Final Four, right? You're not giving me your Final Four today, are you?
I don't. You know me, I don't deal in Final Four. I deal in game-by-game progression. I finished the tournament 13-2 last year. Off to a great start this week. South Dakota State Tuesday, Texas Southern last night. I'm releasing my fourth straight guaranteed winner on BrianLang.com. If I don't hit this play today, you get Saturday's 200 dimer, number two in a row, absolutely free. I'm absolutely on fire right now. You'd be absolutely clueless if you didn't take advantage of that today at BrianLang.com.
All right, Brendan, let's see. I can't believe I'll be in Vegas. I guess we'll see how much I can take care of you. I will at least buy you dinner, but we'll figure out where it's going to be. But unless Duke, you see my Duke go all the way, and then it's double or nothing. Duke, let's go for it. Let's see what happens. Duke to win the national championship. Because Zion Williamson is one of the best players to ever play in college basketball, and he's going to put on a clinic in this tournament.
Okay. You're double or nothing on Duke to win it all. I'll take the field. Good luck.
All right, Brandon. Good talking to you, man. Take care.
Bye, buddy.
I'd say bye. You're listening to Neil Haley's show. We'll be back in just a moment. Hi, everyone, and welcome to the Neil Haley Network's Caregiver Dave celebrity segment. And guess what? You know, we've gone through so many interesting celebrities. I'm like, I have to talk to somebody I really believe is a rock star. And the reason is because he's been on every different show in the world. We're talking today about one thing, but how about we have Caregiver Dave here? Caregiver Dave, how are you? And you know what? Dave, it's just amazing, and you keep always, you know, talking about how your life has turned around because of specific reasons, but you were training yourself for this, man. You had this in you all the time.
Well, that's obviously there are ingredients in us, all of us, that we don't even know are there. They're like hidden DNA, hidden things that other people can see. But when they mention them to us, as people have to me in the past, I mean, we look at them like a deer in the headlights because, hey, you're talking to me? You know, I don't see that. And they says, well, that's because you're not looking. And it's true. You know, sometimes you can't see the forest because you're too far in the forest to see the trees. But, yeah, thank you.
Yeah, absolutely. So our topic tonight is not about all the speaking he does, the television shows. One thing, his mission is to help people right now, and meaning help them in a way if you're a caregiver. Caregivers deal with such burnout. It's such a challenge for them. And Dave has the answer for a very affordable, but also valuable. It's affordable, but I think it provides so much value involving your membership site, because that is a key place where you're going to get all the tools necessary to help you through these challenges in caregiving. Right, Dave?
Absolutely. You know, I was coaching for years, and even as a teenager, I would coach my friends, you know, how to get a girl, or if they broke up, how to make up with the girl, because I just had this wisdom. Apparently this was a gift of mine. And so I've been coaching, I counsel in my church. I know how to solve problems. I know how to solve my own problems, other people's problems, and believe it or not, the world's problems. But during my coaching activities, I noticed that only about 10% of the people that I coach with great pearls of wisdom would take my advice and actually do it. The others would listen and say, oh, yeah, that's a good idea, that's a good idea. I'll get back to them in a month or two. And so how's it going? Oh, it's getting worse. Well, did you do what I told you to do? No. Why not? Oh, you know, and you hear every lame excuse in the book. So someone told me, another coach told me, that's because you're not charging them. I says, well, they don't have any money. I says, yes, they do. People have money for all sorts of things. Just go and look in their closet, and you'll see a bunch of stuff that they don't need, that they wanted. And so I started charging for my coaching. And all of a sudden, something amazing happened. People started showing up for the calls, doing the homework, right, getting the results that they wanted. Because before, when it was free, people value what you pay.
Exactly.
You have no skin in the game. If it didn't cost you anything, then it's worth what you paid for it. Nothing. And so that's a very important lesson. So caregivers are notorious for being that way. You know, they just give and give and give. There's nothing left to give. They're the last guy on the totem pole. They'll give their loved one, you know, the last food in the cabinet, and they'll go hungry, or they'll give the shirt off their back. And unfortunately, that's what makes them burn out. That's what makes them, you know, be sleep deprived and eat junk food every night because they're giving the good food to their loved one. And so they've got to understand, with the same principle that I just said, that unless they pay for this advice, and I made it very, very affordable. I mean, it's a no-brainer. But they don't value it. So
yeah,
I have a membership site that is only $49. Not a week, not a month, not a year, but it's a one-time $49 fee. Now, who can't afford that? I know a lot of caregivers who are broke, and they'll put some stupid thing on their credit card from QVC that they emotionally got caught up, and they don't even need it, and it stays in the package for a year. I know people like this. So don't tell me they can't afford to spend $49 for me to save their life, since 30% of caregivers die before their loved ones do, or to keep them from a hospital trip to the ER when the rest of them become sicker than the ones they're caring for and eventually need a caregiver of their own. So that's my story.
And see, I think it's such a valuable story when you talk about caregiving, and it doesn't matter if you're talking elderly or somebody that's has certain, or even children, you can burn yourself out if you work all the time, then you go home and you don't stop. And there's no relaxation and there's no glory. It becomes very, very, very draining. And if you don't have that support and you don't think about me, as you talked about, I remember you on shows talk about this, you can become very drained and your health can drain as well. And a lot of it has to do with how you feel as a caregiver when the stress comes. How are you responding to stress? Are you responding with being positive, or are you really being negative? Because what happens, Dave, when you really kind of become negative when you're taking care of somebody?
Well, yeah, everyone is different, and it depends on their DNA, depends on how they were raised, depends on their environment. You know, when life throws you a challenge, you have two choices. You can either let it make you bitter, B-I-T-T-E-R, or you can let it make you better, B-E-T-T-E-R. And the choice is yours. It's the old analogy, is the glass half empty or is the glass half full? You know, a lot of people, when caregivers get stress and strife from their loved one, a lot of times it's their fault because they never implemented any boundaries. They never told their loved one what was and what was not acceptable. You know, like, this is the line that I do not want you to cross, and if you cross it, then there will be consequences to bear. But a lot of caregivers, they don't like confrontation. I mean, who does like confrontation?
No, not at all.
I like confrontation, but
on my radio show, I like it, Dave, but I don't like confrontation at home. No. I'll be fine confronting somebody somewhere else, but it's still it drains you, Dave. It does in so many ways. So,
and it doesn't do any good anyway.
Right. So let's kind of go right into what this membership entails. What do you get?
Well, I'm going to make a special offer in addition to everything that I'm going to tell you that you're going to get, because I want to see if anybody on your show, because you've got a great audience and you've got a great reach global, I want to see how many of your people are going to take advantage of a good deal. So right off the top, I'm going to throw in a 60-minute coaching call, and or you can either become a guest on my radio show, Dave, the Caregiver's Caregiver, and I'll give you the 60-minute coaching call as well. And I don't know about you, but I charge $300 for a 60-minute coaching call, and that's the amount that people are willing to pay because they get a lot of wisdom. So in addition to that free coaching call, and that's going to be with the calls, let's say how much time should we give them to respond to this so that we know?
It depends on how long I promote it, Dave, because it's going to get out to a bunch of places. So give it some time because I'm telling you, you wouldn't believe how things work. And I have a story for you off air about that. But I know how to get information out there to drive traffic. So, Dave, that's a perfect
deal.
I don't know. I'll tell you. We will say when it's over. But you got to say you listened to this on the Neil Haley Show. That's all. And that's and then that's it. That's perfect. So, Dave, what else does the membership entail?
Well, we have weekly group coaching calls. So it's like group therapy, right? Anybody ever been in group therapy? A lot of times, I don't even have to say anything because the group is full of caregivers who are going through what you're going through. And by the way, everything that a caregiver goes through, normal people go through as well. Normal people get burned out who are not caregivers. You know, normal people start getting lazy and don't eat right and they don't sleep right and they get sleep deprived. So all this is good for anybody. And even if you're not a caregiver, I always like to say, just wait. You're either going to become one or you're going to need one. So now is the time to learn how to be a caregiver, and you'll be learning qualities that will help you better in life anyway. So in addition to the one-hour coaching call that I said that you have to mention Neil Haley's name, you get a weekly group coaching call. That's worth $100 right there. My bestseller, It's My Life to Reclaim Your Caregiver Sanity by Learning When to Say Yes and When to Say No. That's a $20 value. I'm going to send you that free. My ebook about overcoming unbelievable hardships, which is my story about my wife and I, how we managed to get through 2 years of grief after she suffered a massive stroke, left her severely speech impaired, paralyzed on the right side. You know, and we didn't kill ourselves. I didn't kill her. She didn't kill me. We managed to survive. We managed to fall in love all over again and be happy. And we're living the new normal. Now, she still can't talk, but she can communicate nonverbally through Pictionary and charades, two games I hate, by the way, but I'm still learning to love. And she's in a power chair. And that chair, we travel all over the world, you know. And anyone
That's
who
great.
Meets her for
yeah.
the first time is amazed at how she's like a one-arm wallpaper hanger, like a cross between Martha Stewart and Wonder Woman. She just makes all of us people look like whiners and complainers. Now, she's got an attitude. People just are just so inspired when they meet her, and she has a purpose in life. You know, I've learned that anytime something bad happens to people, right? Everyone wonders, why do bad things happen to good people? Well, quite often, if you just give that a little time, that bad thing becomes a very good thing. And I can certainly say that for our lives, because we wouldn't be the people we are if we didn't go through this trial and this heartache, you know. So what else do you get? You get, I've got a USB credit card sized USB. I don't know what you call them besides the USB thing. And it's 25 of my most popular radio shows. You can listen to it in your car. If your car has got a USB port, you can listen to it on your computer. You can listen to it on your phones now. They've got a connection for that. I've got 7 Thrive Packs. They're worth about $135 each. So if you're a new, brand new caregiver, and you don't know what the heck you're doing, then these Thrive Packs will get you back on track. If you are a veteran caregiver and you've kind of gotten off the track, they will help you to get back on track. So they talk about things like depression, things like, you know, how do you implement boundaries in your life? You know, how do you deal with a difficult loved one? Like it says, these are not just caregiver issues. These are issues of life. We've also got our private Facebook group, and this is a bunch of – we've got 2 Facebook groups. We've got the public one. I have about 35,600 followers and people who have liked our Facebook page. And then we've got a smaller one that I just recently started, probably got about 35 in there. And that's for the people, you know, who just want a smaller environment. You know what they say, what happens in Vegas stays in Vegas, you know.
Right.
You just want
exactly.
You don't want to share it with the world, so to speak. It's a private group. You need to be approved to enter, and I ask some questions, and based on the answers to the questions, I either let you come in or keep you out. And so, like I said, this is almost like a group therapy thing. Everyone in this group is a caregiver or has been a caregiver and has got a heart of helping people, you know. So you say, okay, here's my problem. You know, my mother just keeps making me feel guilty. You know, I don't know what to do. And then we'll say, oh, you know, I had that problem. Here's what I did to solve that problem. Someone else will say, oh, yeah, well, try this. I did this. And, you know, that really helped. And so it's hearing the experts tell you what works for them. And you can either do one of two things. You can make your own mistakes and learn that way, or you can learn by other people's mistakes. So I prefer the latter. Also, what you get, unlimited access to all of my videos and podcasts. Now, I have over 100 video series that I started. It's called Dave's Hammock Wisdom, 5 minutes of Dave's Hammock Wisdom. And why do I call it that? Because, like I said, I was blessed with a lot of wisdom throughout my life, and I usually get this wisdom when I lay on my hammock. I solve the world's problems. I solve my problems. I solve my friends' problems. And about 18 months ago, I says, you know, Dave, you are so selfish. You're keeping all this wisdom to yourself. You need to share it with the world. So I started doing Facebook Live videos roughly every week and a half, something like that. I've got over 100 of them, and they're just little snippets of wisdom. So if you're having a fight with somebody or you're just frustrated, you're at the end of your rope, go lock yourself in the bathroom. And all it takes is 5 minutes to find the topic that you're dealing with at that moment. Listen to it. You come out a new person, energized, invigorated. I've also got all of my podcasts. I've got, gosh, how many podcasts do I have? 250 at least. I've been doing this for 5 years. Yeah, that's about right. And many of them have become video casts. So you need an hour because they're all an hour long. Just take an hour of me time. Lock the door. When you're giving your loved one a nap or whatever, let them know, hey, between 1 and 2, this is my time. And unless you're dying, I don't want to be disturbed.
Wow, Dave.
And so,
oh, my gosh. I can't believe all the stuff that is offered.
I hope you're writing this down.
Yeah, go to caregiverdave.com. Dave's going to throw in a shirt as well. No, I'm just kidding. But we got to get you the merchandise, the hats, the T-shirts, and the coffee cups next, Dave. So everyone needs to go right now to caregiverdave.com. Right, Dave?
Caregiverdave.com. That's right.
And then that's all they need to do. And again, if you're watching the video or radio show or wherever, make sure you go ahead if you're a caregiver. And if you're not a caregiver, please share this with caregivers. Because I really believe
you might be saving their life. You
exactly.
Know?
It is what it is. So I appreciate you coming on, Dave. A lot of fun next week back to celebritydom. But you were the celebrity this week. And Dave, love chatting with you and talk to you next week, man.
Thank you.
All right, bye-bye. You'll listen to Neil Haley's show when we'll be back in just a moment. Hi, everyone, okay. And welcome again to the Neil Haley Show's Total Education Hour segment, and I'm with Dr. Stephen Gavanti, and his literacy campaign is going really well, and a lot of exciting news to come, and we're getting down to the nitty-gritty where we really need people to help us today, right, to get to your goal, to meet your goal.
Absolutely. We got 2 weeks left. We're at 20% of goal, and people who aren't donating or who have donated are spreading the word, which is very helpful. Let me give you a couple of things that happened just this week. Well, just in the last 7 days. How's
okay,
that?
That's perfect.
So we met with a grandmother's son-in-law who turned out to be an angel investor. Now, his daughter's been using Rocket Phonics, the kit, and of course, he would love to have an app.
That's great.
And he knows the competition well because, you know, he's bought the competition to help his daughter read. but nothing has touched her like Rocket Phonics has. So if he donates, we will be able to do the first app, the first level, as they say in the game world, and animate it. So that's great. What else happened? Tomorrow, I'm going to meet with a literacy group that may well fund a Rocket Phonics using the kit.
Oh, wow.
To teach the low-income kids and here in Sarasota. But that would be great because, you know, if we get five kits, that's $1,000. And then what's next?
We need people's help. That's what's next. We need people to go right now to Indiegogo, and the link will be in all the different show descriptions. Go there.
Please.
Go there now and donate. And one of the reasons I'll continue to give the praises of Dr. Stephen Gafonti, I've known him for almost 10 years, is he really wants to break the poverty issue
cycle
through education. Education is the key. Without education.
It goes deeper than that.
Go ahead.
One of my donors has a dyslexic daughter. Now, I don't know if you remember or not, but I'm dyslexic and so is my brother.
I forgot about that, yeah.
There is nothing more depressing than reading in front of a group of kids who are laughing at you.
That's true.
Mm-hmm. I thought I was being funny in some way. What I didn't know was I was just making up the words that I was reading. So that's what they were laughing at. And my brother had the same problem. And what the kit, what the problem will do, what will happen? Hold on a sec.
All right, let me stop the recording for a second. Hold on.
Okay, there you go.
Okay, we're good.
What the app will do is, in its ultimate form, will be to find dyslexics, treat them, and never tell anybody they're dyslexic.
Defeating that program, your program works so much as good or even better than programs for dyslexia, because you're not going to put a Band-Aid on the problem. You're going to, I wouldn't say cure it, but really decrease some of those issues that are occurring through dyslexia.
Yes, it may cure it. It depends on, dyslexia is low phonemic awareness. And like height, phonemic awareness is a bell-shaped curve. You with me?
Yes.
So if we can move them up the bell-shaped curve by working on their phonemic awareness, then we can cure them. And if we can move them up and we can't get them high enough in the phonemic awareness to cure them, we can make it a lot easier. Our strongest competition is Orton Gillingham. And Orton Gillingham gives you three of the top sounds for each letter. Well, a dyslexic is lucky if he can hear one sound. So making them learn three, which is better than anything else that's out there except Rocket Phonics, is, you know, just makes it less successful. So the choice of there are a couple of things going on here. We do better than Orton Gillingham, but we use games. So instead of depressing the child because he's really not getting it, he's just playing a game. He doesn't even have to know that he's learning to read. And with the app, we don't mention it to the child, and we ask the parent not to mention it either.
It's fabulous.